My name is Laura Ritchie. I'm an independent curator operating out of Chibuktuk, Halifax.
And my name is Lisa Hermer. I am an artist based in Guelph. So Weather Collection is a large collaborative digital project looking at weather and art in the context of climate change.
So Edmund Burke, in 1757, he wrote, "Whatever is in any sort terrible or is conversant about terrible objects or operates in a manner analogous to terror is a source of the sublime." John Martin's compositions tend to be good examples of the sublime in action, and certainly Milton's epic poem, Paradise Lost, which is literally about the fall of mankind. It's a good kind of starting point for talking about ways in which the scale in a work can help us understand feeling small in the face of something really big.
Which I think is interesting in the context of where and when it was getting made. So maybe a moment where certain people were feeling a sense of power or control over what would be called the natural world. And so looking for something bigger than the self as an antidote to that. Climate change is also a shift in scale of how humans, which means some humans more than others, are affecting the planet as a whole. So a sense of scale being both very big and very small at the same time, I think, is one of the most disorienting things about climate change.
Often we'll find works by women painters that are relegated to a study collection or an education collection, or, you know, they never get matted or framed or shown, and like this work, kind of get tucked away in a little bit, lead a very small existence in an otherwise really big collection.
Because of the title, it was probably painted in fog, but you almost feel as if that weather has soaked into the paper and become part of the material itself.
So we're looking at J.E.H. MacDonald's Wild Ducks from 1917. What drew you to this?
So I think this is another example of a figure being in a landscape with sort of that feeling of something greater than the self. So in this case, weather, these huge, imposing, and pretty dynamic clouds.
It's rare, too, in J.E.H. MacDonald's compositions, having a figure that's so central. There are certainly earlier examples that have figures in them. Those examples are also quite romanticized. So little tiny travelers, little tiny folks in a snowstorm on a street, street scene. The weather is always bigger.
Yeah, and I think similar to sort of the role of God in the mezzotint we were just looking at, in this case, the thing that's taking the place of something greater than the self is the weather, which is interesting to think about in relation to climate change, because one of the difficult things about climate change is that the weather now feels as though it's deeply implicated with human activity, a particular kind of human activity. And so it is both bigger than ourselves as individuals, but not bigger than ourselves in the way that human action accumulates into these massive planetary effects.
That is in itself anxiety-inducing or emotion-inducing. And so we've kind of had a bit of a role reversal. And I like that when we think using these kind of romantic depictions of the environment and the landscape to help us understand the kind of fiction that is this romanticism in our own situation.
And I think coming back to the idea of power and control, the only way sort of a figure is able to passively exist in what is called wilderness is because of a certain degree of power and control and privilege and access to be able to come to this space and just kind of stare at it wistfully and not think about deeper material engagements and impacts that living in this world have on the more than human world.